Hello, everybody, and welcome back to whatever we're on. It's the GT3 unveiling expose. Oh, yes. Here on simrace.tv. We're just moving through to qualification at the moment. Now, this is the qualification for the final big, huge event. We've just got Langan on your screen there. Currently sitting in P2. This is a private session. Everyone's got one lap only. Very much a shootout-style qualification. And, yeah. Famous, as made famous by lots of other funky things, and what we will do is we will talk you through exactly what's going on. Basically, what I was attempting to commentate on, failing miserably, was one of the preliminary rounds, where the top 15 drivers of that, and the top 15 drivers of the one where you didn't watch, where probably lots of people with names that I could actually say, were on the server, and the top 15 of each have joined matrimony and have found themselves titillating on this server for a private qualifying session where we can all have a good old sing song for a 90 minute dumps, and that's not quite gone to plan. Off down at turn one there is Langan. So he's just. Busy rounding the end of first sector, and he's given up on that. So that's not worked out at all for Langan. As we've now got Gianti. Or Gene T. I think Gene T is quite good for that. He's not looking too bad. So as Gene T, they're just around the top of the hill. Tinny's on his way down. He's looking quite feisty. He done very well in the race that we were watching. Popped in third, second probably by the end of it all, because we saw Piccolo disconnect over the finish line and not be counted. Don't see him in the server at the moment, so I'm assuming that still stands. That's pole position there for Dean T. Oh my god. As we're now watching Mr. Pash himself. He was, I think, 11th it was in our little shindig. Thank you. So as Pash there comes out of the final couple of corners, back with you now that I've recovered from my technical ailments, of which there are quite a few and none of them were sexually transmitted. He pops into ninth position with a 159.494. Ooh, just under the 2 seconds mark down on Koenig, who is in pole position, won the race that we were in. So he delights himself there. Just 3 minutes 20 left to go on the session. Let's just see who else we've got out and about. Most people seem to have just done their times, as that's Vasquez there just slipping down the order into 18th as Wenzel pops into 12th. Let's see what we're up to. There's Petr Kasa, who won the race that we weren't watching. Let's see what he's up to. He's just going to come around. I think it's going to be one of him. I can see Piccolo there is going to second. So he has been allowed to race, so that's nice. Ah, giving in the world as Kasa continues his warm-up lap. Very patriotic top of the car. So, thankfully I've been joined by Simon Miller, who's going to take me through the cameras. I've got limited views myself, so you shall have to bear with me while I stumble about like a madman. Kasa then, down into turn one, and that's not quite the racing line. Just coming back in again. So, quite juicy as it comes up towards turn two. I do love the flow of the Brno circuit. As I said earlier in the broadcast, it reminds me very much of Zandvoort, but just a little bit more flowing and less sand dunes. Let's see what he's like as he comes up to the end of the first sector. Of course, he's not going to have any traffic because we're in a private session. And that's 44,000 down then at the end of sector one. So not looking too bad at all between himself, Koenig, and Golo. Kenneth Gina T is third currently with Rowan in four. So definitely looking at spearheading to the top of the field so far for Kasa, running right the way out to the very edge of the circuit. He's attacking the curves, but he's not abusing them like what we saw quite a few people do earlier on, as someone pops into pole position for 157.9. Let's see what Kasa's doing here, braking. Not much at all, actually. This car particularly heavy on the front end, I've been told. So that might be why he's having to take some more wider berths into the corner as opposed to out. But he's a tenth up now. And suddenly, Koenig with his 157.549, which is slower than what they managed in pole position last time round. Of course, they had 20 minutes in which to get to that hot lap time. Is now very much under threat. Around the final chicane we go. On to the start-finish straight. Nick Rowland pops in 19th there with the 202. But Kasa is going to smash that with... Oh no, second position. 64,000 behind. He lost it in that final little chicane. I can't believe the amount of time that is won and lost just round that final little flicky-flack sector. And down to second he goes. Koenig there continues to keep pole position. Time has hit zero. And that is that. Of course, we're only allowed one lap per person. And I think that just about covers it up there. So we'll go through the grid when it comes round to griddy time. This is going to be a 90-minute feature race. I do enjoy a race with nice features. And there is your pole sitter Koenig there, basking in the pit lane. So, a quick run through of the grid then. Andreas Koenig on pole position with 157.549. Petr Kasa will be second with Alex Piccolo third, Kenneth Ginty four. Then other names that we've not got, Siggi Schoenen, fifth, Sebastian Rowan, sixth, Thomas Wackenbauer, seven, Christian Siminek, eight, Fabio Cagnoli. I wanted to go off into pasta land for that one. Ninth, Martin Palm, 10, can deal with that. Carson Fisher, 11, Matt Kai, 12, Edgar Osterman, 13, Ryan Walker, 14, Miguel Angel Vasquez in 15th, Mirko Wenzel, 16, Daniel Lagan-Hergman in 17, Manuel Hainel in 18, Andreas Rozak, 19, Nick Roland, 20th, Kai Chizozic, that's not even vaguely near what the name is. Kai Chizuki, 21st. Jörg Langen, 22nd. HM Kraus, 23rd. And Thomas Pasch, who did not complete his lap, will be 24th. I was informed that actually only 14 cars got to the line last time around. There's a couple of people actually that made the top 15 who are not here from my round, so I'm a little bit unsure as to what is going on there. So there's a couple of people that have not really gone to plan. Okay, so just into warm up, just a quick 5 minute shakedown before we get going again. Bart Strubantz is also now onto the grid too, so I think because obviously it was a private session for qualification, allowed to join in. And let's see, I'm just being poked. Not really the first time I could say that open on air. So I'm going to poke him back. So I'm going to tell our little German commentator in the other room, Lutzinger, the man that, the beast behind the wheel that's put this all together, we are ready, steady and a rocking, or as much as we'll ever be. I will, however, pour myself another drink before we get going. Tell you what I did find out today, actually, well, not today, well, it was technically today, although it was about 3 a.m. A little bit of Cointreau on vanilla ice cream. Really nice. I recommend that for all. Doesn't necessarily have to be a holiday season. And if you want to go nuts and make it into a real treat, if you've got some spare harvest crunch, then that makes a tasty crunchy dessert alcoholic treat. Or you could just skip the harvest crunch and the ice cream and just go for alcoholic treat. It's a bit like Money Supermarket, cut out the middleman. So, I've not had anyone tell me what their New Year's plans are yet. That's a thumb up my nose, what's going on? So, I would like to know. What are everyone doing? I've not decided yet. I've been asked out on a date. I don't think that's very good for New Year's, especially if it's not local to the area, because you know I'm just going to get raped. Then it does make me worry. And although I do live in Harlow, Essex, it doesn't mean that I automatically have to have an STD before the age of 30. So I'm not so sure that one will work out. Of course, you can join in our chat room. Because you know you might want to. I'm just making my way there now to chat with you wonderful people. Oh, it's Alex Cooper. Hello, Alex. What are you doing for Christmas? For Christmas? For New Year. Who else have we got? Natter04 as well. Hello, welcome. I do like interactivity. Probably why everyone pokes me. Insensitive places. There isn't an insensitive place on my body. However, I would like to point out to everyone that despite my drunken shenanigans here this evening, I have actually popped myself down for a little competition, which I'm just going to whore myself out for, considering we are whoring out the mod that's on your screen. Well, not necessarily on your screen. There's a lovely piece of grass on your screen at the moment. For Autodrome International. No, I won't. You know what? That grass is looking lovely. We saw Rambo in it in our feature race doing proper camouflage. It was good. For Autosport International, I've got a little video going, so you can pop across. I popped it in the race department, little forum shindig thingamibob. Go and have a giggle. Give it a thumbs up on YouTube. Never know, I might be drunk and commentating near you soon. So, no German precision going on this evening. I think they're just busy getting themselves sorted out and in order. It's going to be a 90-minute sprint race. No, it's not. It's going to be... I don't know what we're doing. It's a 90-minute feature race. We're looking at everyone doing at least one pit stop, I'd have thought. And I've not heard particularly that tyre wear is a massive issue, so we shall see. But it'll be interesting to see just exactly how this mod then handles elsewhere, and to see how the characteristics of the car change throughout these stints as we move forward to this bizarre 8-minute trundle round to the grid. It could be called a reconnaissance lap. I like to call it a trundle. Trundle sounds less intimidating. It's been told that in the Grid 2 race there's a little bit of shenanigans going on around the reconnaissance lap. I really had to think so that I could say the word reconnaissance. It's one of those words that once you've had half a bottle of brandy, it's a little bit of a drama to push through your lips. So yeah, race is on. Battle is joined as they come flying out of the pit lane towards the grid. So that is a good point actually that my cameraman has just jokingly said in the ear. Fuel obviously is being used around this. So now what I would do is I wouldn't come out straight away. I'd creep round at the last minute. So then I've not even burnt up fuel on the grid, because unless you switch your engine off, which I just wouldn't dare do because I'd be so busy pooing it thinking, oh god, I'm not going to be able to restart it later on. You just burn green fuel for 8 minutes. Admittedly, I'm a very, very low heat. But It can't be good. Welcome to the chat room, Night Stalker, as well. apparently you should be on this race, my friend. Come on, pop in. You know you wanna. You make me wanna do 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 do. So we're just watching everyone flollop round to the grid. Oh, cameraman, cameraman, what are you doing for New Year? Nout? Nout?
He is not running yet.
Indeed. Oh, I wouldn't suggest hanging around that shady character. Yes, just catching up with the news actually from the grid too, which we didn't see on the broadcast. Apparently one of our people on the grid, Nick Rowland, unfortunately got a jump start penalty. So let's hope he's not got frog's legs on him again. Second time lucky. Or second time unlucky, for that fact. As the grid continues to stream itself round to form. Some of them haven't bothered making it onto the grid yet. Petacazza there in second position, just forming himself round. I think this grid is taking it a lot more casually than ours, which is why I was getting very excited, because almost every single driver bolted round as quickly as they could on our one. And then I was left a very confused bunny when they all decided to stop. I thought that they were going to try some kind of, I can bog you out any day, come on then. With me, as they sat on the grid, and I looked slightly scared. Apparently, some of the grid in Grid 2 also forgot that it's a rolling start, and decided to go racing straight away. So, sounds like an interesting affair that the Grid 2 people have. Hopefully, they're not bringing with them that sentiment to this race here. Although, if they do, it might wake me up a little bit. So yeah, here they come onto the grid itself. We've still got 3 minutes to get round, so if I were you, Koning. Oh, God. Okay, 3 minutes till the pit closes, 2 minutes until we get going. I could have ordered a curry. Oh, or at least a hooker. Maybe. Look here, Sonny. He starts waving my finger at the screen. Need to get myself watered. So, someone's saying in the chat room that Petacazza has lined up on the wrong spot. I don't think that's true. I think Petter would like to say pole is his, but unfortunately it wasn't. Yeah. So, just slightly off topic actually, while someone has mentioned the word Senna in my ear. The legend that he was indeed. Has anyone seen, because Senna picked up, I noticed, an award actually for Best Film of the Year, which is a fantastic documentary. If you've not seen it, you need to go and pick it up now, otherwise I may come round and sit on your face, which is just generally not good for survival. Has anyone actually seen the TT documentary? Because I was eyeing it up today in a shop, thinking, I don't know if you're actually just riding off the crest of the wave that was the Senna documentary, or if you're actually any good yourself. As there you can see, pole position man squirming his way through. Oh, I'd be a little bit scared doing that. There's something quite nice about having that, will everyone just leave the bloody grid, and then you just kind of click and you run. I like that. I like routine. This is throwing me out. Hmm. And maybe that's something they could stick in for R Factor 2, just having just a random bra-clad lady in polygons just splattered all over the car. Not preferably not run over. That's true. Yeah, Tanya from the German channel versus Martin Brundle running around on the grid. I wonder if we'll get that again. I don't know, because Brundle, I don't think, will be taking the main commentating duties over on this new Sky shindig we've got going on. So it remains to see exactly how that all turns out. I tell you what else remains to be seen, apart from my underwear on air. Who's going to win this old race-a-roo? So we're going to get going in go. So the race is underway. Don't get too excited all at once. We've got a formation lap to sort out first. There is Koning in pole position. Petter Kazza will start off alongside him. So Andrej Koenig is on pole position. Let's have a look at him. Second on the grid will be Petter Kazza, Toro Motorsport. Third will be Alex Piccolo. Fourth will be Kenneth Ginty, Ford. Fifth will be Siggy Schroening. Because I think the cameraman's more drunk than I am. Sixth, Sebastian Rodin. Thomas Wackenbauer is 7th, hoping to make another podium potentially today. Christian Simunic 8th, more about Martin Palm 9th, second in the Touring cars, and Carsten Fischer rounds out the top 10. There he is, white and red. 11th is Kai Matz, doormat. Edgar Osterman, 12th, for race day speed. 13th, Ryan Walker, big up the Scots. Why? Shock and trolley, you'll have a field day. 14th, Miguel Angel, or Angel, sorry, Vasquez. 15th, Mirko Wenzel. He's related to, what was that scarecrow? That's going to remind me now. Come back to me. I've got my head as Rapunzel. 16th is Daniel Langenherman. 17th, there's a shot by Nick Rowland. 18th, Andreas Rozak. 19th, Kai. 20th, Jörg Langen. 21st, Achim Krauss. 22nd, 3rd of the R Factor Racing. X Factor. I was trying to avoid any cowl references there. Thomas Pash, 23rd, on the grid being Bart Strubanz. Yeah. And Fabio Cagnoli in the Ferrari rounds off the grid. And he needs to catch up with everyone else. That's your 24 that have bothered to come back. That's from Takeshi's Castle. You lose more and more each round you go. Unfortunately, there's not a Craig's Ridiculous Replay, although this could be a Ridiculous Replay as they come out of the final curve, because Kazza looks like he's a little bit further ahead than Koenig was as he comes around the final corner, just trying to position himself. We are go, and well, Kassa's been caught napping, and Alex Piccolo is having a right good nuzzle through down onto the inside into turn one, and Piccolo's got it. Kazza drops down to third position. Through looks like he's going to go GT2 there in the Ford. And suddenly Kazza, looking a little bit like an angry mongrel coming out the final corner, has been down-dogged down to third position. Ginty follows through. Or is that Schroening there? Yeah, it's Siggy Schroening there, who's up into fourth position, sorry, ahead of Ginty. Up one goes Simunic to 7th, Wackenbauer has gone down to 8th. Osterman has overtaken Kai Matt, and Langan has overtaken Tchaikovsky as well for 19th and 20th position, so there's been a few movers and shakers off the line, not a dramatic great deal. Although Fabio Cagnoli is up into 21st position, he's gained 4 positions, so that's worked out nice. 3 positions, that's gained well for him. Everyone else going through quite alright. There's a little bit of a touch on the back of one of the green cars. I think that was Kai Matt there and Ryan Walker getting together over 12th and 13th positions. They've continued on as normal though, but once again, Coney there is now ahead of Alex Piccolo, who wants to put that checkered flag back on his name after he disconnected crossing the line last time by. There's a couple of changes of positions there going on. That was Carsten Fischer and Osterman there side by side. Nick Rowland's just got round high match for 13th position as well at the corner of your screens. But as the field streams through the lens, we have Koenig, Piccolo, Kasser, Schoen, Ginty, Rowan, Wackbauer, Palm, Fischer, Osterman, your top 10. And everyone starting to just slip themselves down. Bart Strubantz and Achim Krauss have retired. They've crashed out. So Strubantz there, unfortunate end to his race. Not quite sure he should have got through. Here comes Kai Matt being attacked by Ryan Walker, or going around the outside of Ryan Walker actually, or was that Wenzel? I'm not sure. That's Wenzel. Oh, and who's that off? That's someone going very, very wrong. I think that was Vasquez going off into all kinds of problems there. Ernst Langerhorman is out as well. Pash gets back going again, but that was all kicking off there down into turn one. That has been the overtaking move. Oh, he's left on all his own accord there. We saw that a couple of times in the sprint race. People, they're just getting a little bit of a twitcheroo on and off they go. Not good at all. So that's another retirement. We're already down to 21 runners and riders remaining. They can't all keep dropping like flies like this. We'll have no one left and I'll just be sitting here talking even more rubbish than normal. Kronig still leads though from Piccolo. Kasser is third. Ginty four. Rowan, Schroen, Wackenbauer, Palm, Osterman, and now Nick Rowland suddenly finds himself shady being in 10th position. Now he's past Carsten Fischer. Someone else is off further down the back. Simeonik down in 19th position. He's dropped a couple of places, but he's now back on the recovery. He's got, who's that just ahead of me? It's Cagnoli again, and it looks like he's going to do a move on him. Cagnoli's been boxed in behind. Who's that? That's Rozak there in 17th position. That's good boxing, clever moving, because that has pushed him up a place, and next up will be Rozak for him to go back through again. Simeonik spent the entire round of qualification going back up the order after having troubles earlier on, so he's no stranger to burning from the back. I think he wished he'd never been there. What on earth is Rozak doing there? That's a little bit extreme off-road running. That is where we saw an onboard crash earlier on, didn't we? So people really struggling with some of the gradients, as Piccolo there having to go and chop across Kasser of the second and third positions. Kronig the first person to go into the 159s with the fastest lap, 159.180. Someone's in the pits, I think that's Thomas Pash in the 21st, but no bother with him, he's all on his own. That's been a change of position there. Sebastian Rowan has got round Schroen. Someone else has changed position. Nick Rowland has just got through on Edgar Osterman in 9th and 10th position. Kai Matt has retaken Ryan Walker for 12th and 13th as well. So it's all kicking off as people start developing into little small clumps of cars. And that has been the way. There's Kronig there, a 158.134 fastest lap. Over a second clear from Alex Piccolo, so he's really laying down the gauntlet. Of course, now that we're in the feature race, different people are using different tactics throughout this, so people might be slightly lower on fuel, they might have different boost settings, they could have all kinds of shenanigans and technical wizardry to keep them going, to give them the pace. Cups. somebody. Am I coming across slightly quietly? I'm not sure. I shall try and turn myself up if I can. Apologies for that.
Peek-a-boo.
There you can see. So, while I try and talk myself out, I could just shout a little bit. Loving that little Norway sign on the top of Cass's car. Is he Norwegian, or is he just being a little bit homesick for somewhere else? He is Norwegian, that is good to know. The truth is unveiled there. Nice reindeer. I wonder if he... actually, I have to ask Peter Kazza, have you eaten a reindeer? Christian Siminik has just crashed out from 21st position. He's out of the race. So we're now down to just 20. And Vasquez there has been off with a 2 minute 11. So he's in trouble too in 20th. As Koenig continues to lead from Piccolo, the gap now 1.7 seconds. Kassa is third, GMT Roan, Schroenen, Wackenbauer, Palm, Roland and Ostermann in the top 10. Good run by Carsten Fischer for 11. Kai, Matt and Ryan Walker still battling over 12th and 13th as they have done all race. Mirko Wenzel is keeping them a watching brief too. There's Martin Palm on your screen being harried by Nick Roland in the Ferrari. So, I've seen that car elsewhere actually, on Martin Palm, as he's running out two wheels on the dirt. Black stuff, I was just about to say the same thing myself, Mr. Tweety Man in my ears. That car is that ugly. That is a car only a mother could love. I couldn't. I wouldn't. I certainly wouldn't bring it home for dinner. The car behind looks quite sexual though. The problem is that it does have those little fangs on the livery. As Roland fancying a quick snifferoo up Palm's rear, but Palm is too busy off-roading across the grass. People need to realise that that's not necessarily the quickest way. In fact, Palm looking very, very edgy. And that's not the racing line either. And it's almost as if he can feel that things are starting to slip away from him as Roland continues to harry him down. Battle for 8th position. Currently they're 10 seconds off the leader. Palm continues to cling on. Looks like he's got himself back under recovery. There's a good little trio going on ahead of us actually. Between Roan, Schroenen and Wackenbauer. 5, 6 and 7. Quite like the yellow livery. That's quite sweet. Oh, so who's that facing the wrong way? Is that... That is either Koenig or Piccolo. Is Koenig, our race leader, facing the wrong way? What on earth happened there? Was it just losing it off his own accord? Yes, it was. That's nuts. That was kind of like an... I'll have a half spin. I'll get it. I've got it. I've got it. No. That was bizarre looking. A moment there. So Alex Piccolo pops into the lead. Kassa is now second, keeping a watching brief. GMT is now to third. Suddenly this battle for fifth is now one for fourth as Roan, Schroenen and Wackenbauer continue, and that is Siggy having a look at Sebastian, the fourth and fifth position. I wonder if he gets sponsored for having his first name called Siggy. With that, I wonder if he comes with a health warning. As Wackenbauer, they're having a good go. As he comes through and doesn't really make a move there at all. If anyone remembers the program Rainbow, we have a Siggy. We've got a brother called Zibby. That could be. Zig and Zag, they need to come back. But yeah, Piccolo continues to lead by 7/10 there. Nick Rowland has just overtaken Kroning for 8th and 9th position, so Kroning, they're not recovering well, and that's problems for Schroen in there. He just caught the rear bumper of Rowan and very lucky to hold that one together. These cars do seem particularly skittish as Cagnaioli has just taken Rozak for 18th and 19th positions. Yeah, it's very, very skittish, these cars, and they do seem to react to, like, people trying to oversteer them. So they do seem to just switch off for no apparent reason as we come down the straight. Apparently everyone's been running quite low rings for this type of race, because obviously it's, although the corners, there are quite a few of them, as I need to get him the orienteering guide out, because he looked like he was going to dive off into the bushes for that turn. Because although there are plenty of corners, they are quite fast, these corners, and you spend a lot of time in them, so you can kind of afford to go in with less wing because you're taking more speed around it. And with the straight's been quite long as well. That obviously takes a big factor in, as once again Schroen attacking Sebastian for all he's worth. Wackenbauer is just taking the watching brief and seeing at the moment. I think he feels that these two are going to come to boiling point sooner or later, as we're coming up for the 15 minute mark quite soon. So, let's see what Schroen is up to now. Taking a little peeky poop whenever he can. That the Ferrari is quicker through the turns, but the Alpine ahead is once again, he decides he's doing like half moves. He just needs to commit to something properly and make sure that he's at least got half a run on him when he does so, because that's not looking good at all. As there you can see the order on your screen, Brolin's got past Palm for 7th and 8th position, it says on that. We'll double check that in a second. Kai Chiosky has also dropped 2 positions down to 18th, so he's not had a good run. As, what is that? Oh dearie me, someone's round like a spinning top. And ooh, very, very close there. And it's Kroning once again. Well, he was like a bullet in our little sprint round. Obviously maybe the extra fuel really, really playing against him, because he's struggling like a mad thing, as Andrej, as he is now down to, well, he won't be in 10th position now, he'll be in 11th, because as he's just looking so skittish, like a skipping stone almost. So let's see exactly what he's doing to his steering wheel to cause all of this drama, as he begins to close back in on Carson Fisher, who now suddenly finds himself in 10th position just by being a good little boy. Let's see if he's even going to attempt an overtake here, because he's just being bullied basically left, right and centre. 20 cars still remaining, he's now in the bottom half of the field. You didn't expect that from a man who was on pole position to be 10 positions further behind, as once again he's just falling right onto the back of him. It's not working at all. He's looking left, he's looking right, he's going to try and force his way through here on Carsten Fisher. Fisher gives up the position, but he's making him work for it. He didn't give him even basically the car's room, and that was the lot. Up into 10th position, good move there by Kroning, but he's got an awful lot to do. He's 22 seconds behind now. Needs to sort himself out. Piccolo still leads from Casa, Jean T. Rowe and Schroen Wackbauer. That battle is on your screen at the moment for 4, 5 and 6. Roland is in 7th position. Palm, Osterman and Kroning round out your top 10. The only other change in position is that Jörg Langen has just overtaken Ryan Walker for 13th and 14th positions. So Walker going down the field as the race continues to progress. There's a faster time standings on your screen there, so that's interesting to see where everyone's petering in. And there you can see Carsten Fischer down in 13th position. Didn't have much luck there to deal with anything, as once again another wobble for another car. And, yeah, this car being put very much under its paces here because those brake discs are glowing. I might get out a shrimp and pop it on. As Chikovsky has just overtaken Miguel Angel Vazquez, who has retired from 20th position, so we've only got 19 runners and riders left now, dropping like flies. Position. So everyone's starting to get themselves into line. That's Chikovsky there in 19th position, still going, but that's all that we've got left, I'm afraid. There's Carson Fisher there, still continues to hold 11th position ahead of Kai Matt. Oh, Matt was half a second quicker last lap by, so that's a potential one. And Jörg Langen there was a second faster than the pair of them, so he could very well start getting himself into the action. In fact, as Walker lost another position, he's down to 15th on my list. Where has he gone to? He's disappeared. Let's wait to see whether or not he comes back onto the server or not. That would be a shame there for Walker as he has disconnected. Yes, he has. He's out. Disconnection there for Ryan Walker. We're down to 18. It's like an elimination event. Oh, this could be why. Let's have a look. Under attack and under pressure. Is the Scott going to blow it? No, it's out. That's very strange. It's not the kind of person that would give up, but there we go. Anyway, lap 10. Still 70 minutes left to go of this slightly confusing German action. I've seen 70-minute German actions before, and it's never quite looked like this. Piccolo continues to lead from Peter Casa by just 1.3. Hang on, he pops. That's, yeah, that's a good point, actually. Maybe we should sell some tickets to Max Mosley. See exactly who he brings down, exactly what insignias they stick on their uniform. Kiasa second, third will be Kenneth Jeansey, fourth Sebastian Rowan, who's looking a little bit wobbly under braking, and he's done well to soak up the pressure so far. He's been like a little sponge, bless him. But it's a very hard car to drive, that Alpina. It's very sluggish and it takes a specific character to be able to make it work. Roan's doing it so far. Siggy is busy closing him in, and that's the closest I've seen Wackenbauer really get involved in this battle for a little while. So obviously he's getting impatient. We saw this actually in a qualification race. He was running quite comfortably in third, hounding the top two, or at least keeping with them. But then once he'd done his little mini spin and dropped a few positions down the order, he didn't bother to actually attack anyone else. He just kept going, because I think he knew he was still in the top 15. This isn't going to work here, Thomas. Need to get it going, as once again, Siggy, what are you doing, my man? Four wheels under braking, looking a little bit ragged. If the Spice Girls could call that a move, they'd call it a Siggy Siggy R. I'd call it a little bit out of control myself. As we come over the crest of the hill, down to the last couple of turns to finish off this lap. Sizing himself up, this is actually looking like one of the best opportunities he's had so far. Unfortunately, that big green booger has got better straight line speed than the car behind it. He's had the need to go defensive though. Siggy's going to try and brave it round the outside. It'll be a tough job if he does so. If he's vaguely alongside though, he can still then have a go down to turn two and have the inside line. That's exactly what he's thinking. Side by side they go. Sebastian versus Siggy. He's got a better run as well, and he's got the car alongside and through before he even gets to the next corner. Fantastic move there by Siggy Sherbrone. Flashes his lights. Don't quite know what for. Was that a thanking you? Or was that from Sebastian behind? Maybe there was a smitty bit of camera. a contact between the two. What a shame if there was, but that was a great move, and he's feeling the need to go very defensive. That's not going to work at all. He's going to be all over the place, and very, very lucky to stay on, and that's going to allow Sebastian straight back along through again. There's not going to be contact here, is there? No! Just about being able to keep that out of each other's bumpers. These camera angles are a little bit scary, because it just seems to crawl in a draw distance a little bit worse than what maybe it potentially is. Wackenbauer still keeps it watching brief and sixth, not daring to get involved. I think he's still going to win Pashmina of the race award, because he's just being very dainty about it. Well, Nick Rowland in seventh position is starting to look like an ominous presence behind them though. So this three carriage train is suddenly going to become a four carriage train if it hasn't already. And well, that could be recipe for disaster. And Peekaboo Petagazza, he's fancying a little bit of Ocarina of Time as he comes up along Alex Piccolo. And let's see what he's doing. These camera angles make it look like they're closer and further apart different times. Piccolo, much different line into turn one, cuts right across. That's not going to look good at all. Koning is off again. He's dropped down from 10th to 13th position. That man obviously feeling like he needs to be in Dirt 3 as opposed to R Factor 1. But I'm sure he's enjoying his time out there today. But the battle for the lead, Piccolo versus Casa. And Piccolo has not really been under pressure very much during this evening of entertainment. Casa is looking like he's going to put every ounce that he can on him. It's these two who have got 6 seconds advantage over Kenneth in third, who's a further 4 seconds ahead of Schroning, who has got past Roan, obviously. After all that, contact between the two there, under braking as well, very, very dramatic. Kronig is in the pits now in 16th position, so obviously he feels the need for some new rubber. And the cars continue on their way again. Jacolo versus Casa. I think Casa's just busy reassessing where he is so that he can then make a comeback over the top of this hill and into the last couple of corners, because down into turn one and two is probably the best opportunity that you've got around this check circuit. Exactly what it looks like he is doing. I don't know if he's actually close enough. It doesn't look like it. If anything, now Piccolo appears to have tried to pick up the pace slightly. Indeed he has. Thomas Pasch has just overtaken Mirko Wenzel for 14th and 15th positions off your screens, and Kai Chikowski is in the pits from 18th and last position. So pit stops are already starting to happen on just lap 13 and 12 rather. So all kicking off there, all kicking off behind as well in a battle for 4, 5, 6 and 7 with Schroen, Rowan, Wackenbauer and Roland. Sounds like something you put in a thing. Mirko Wenzel is out from 16th position. Don't know what's happened to him, but he's just retired just now. And that will be a disconnection by the looks of it, which is a shame for Mirko. Out he doth go. We're down to just 17. Sweet 17. Piccolo still versing Casa for the lead. Jeansy having a little doodle all on his own in third position, minding his own business, as he has done most of this race. Most of all of it, to be fair. And this little collection of cars. Hopefully none of these can disconnect, because otherwise we might be a little bit buggered for entertainment. As they come around the final... not final couple of corners at all. I'm a little bit confused myself. Someone calling the dementia team. There's Rowan there, just once again. It looks like he can take so much, and then he starts getting the wiggle wobble on. and he's struggling. The problem is that Wackenbauer just doesn't seem to feel confident enough to be able to overtake, and that's going to allow Roland to have a look. And if Roland's clever, he may be able to box Wackenbauer in. He's not, because he's not been able to do so. So the British do know the name of Courage, and Rowan versus Wackenbauer. That is the most feistiest I've seen Wackenbauer for a little while. And he's going to fancy doing the switcheroo. We've lost Alexandra Koenig, has just retired as well from 16th, so they're dropping really like flies. Wackenbauer, though, not looking good there in 6th position. And it looks as though Roland's going to go round the outside. Is he going to break too late? Yes, he does, and he flies off the racing line. Wackenbauer keeps the position just for now. And the field continues on. Piccolo, Kasser, Ginty, Schroen, Rowan, Wackenbauer, Roland, Palm, Osterman and Fischer are top 10. Kaimat 11, Fabio Cagnoli up to 12. Jörg Langen 13, Thomas Pasch 14, Andrzej Rozak is 15, and Kai Chikowski will be 16th once he's got round the retired Koenig. And they are your runners and riders left remaining, would you believe? Just the 16 already. It's like a double eviction at Big Brother. Come over the top of the hill there. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa! Mounting between the two there. Wackenbauer had nowhere to go, so the Wack attacks the back of Rowan's rear. But that car has looked like it's been an accident waiting to happen for the last couple of laps. He's done very well to keep it under wraps. It reminds me of Buckaroo, that car, because it just seems to be snapping and wiggling and desperately trying to say, no, I'm not being ruled. The car was a high heel, it would be Gucci. Wackenbauer once again sizing him up down into turn one. But he's so passive. Where's Roland gone? Roland's dropped right back. He's some 4 seconds further back. I think there's been a problem there at some point too. So that gives Wackenbauer enough time to be able to concentrate fully on being aggressive. That's not the way to do it though, because he's not close enough to try and run around the outside. And all the while these two battle. Oh, is that? Oh, it's just a little bit of pixelation from myself there. All the time that these two battle, Roland just reels them back in again, and Wackenbauer is just losing time that he could be properly aggressively attacking. So it's almost like a catch 22. You've just got to pick the right moment to do it. As once again, there's Siggy. Sebastian, just looking like he just wants to throw the car off to the inside. Even Thomas was looking a little bit ragged through there. And now you can see Roland just reeling them all back in again. The gap was 4 seconds. Now it's down to 2. So it's not looking good at all. As once again there, Rowan looking like he's going to go for the, oh, once again just ragged on the exit, and this could be Wackenbauer's best move, and he dives through onto the inside. He takes the corner. That's decisive action there by Thomas, up into 5th position. Just about clinging on there is Rowan. And Nick Rowland there in